Good morning. We're so happy that you took time today and this morning to view our service, view our message, our worship, and our communion that we'll have coming up. I just invite you to not only check us out online, but when we are able to come back to meet again, I just invite you to come back to us. We're located in Raytown, and we'll just be so glad to see you and to have you visit us. I want to open today just a verse that's been going around, but it's been laid on my heart as well as many others. It's from Philippians 4, it's 4 through 7. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, and the Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, be prayer and petition. With thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." What an anxious time it can be, and you're going to hear that today in the message that David's prepared for us. And I just invite you, if you need anything, reach out to us as a church. We'll do what we can to give back and just be able to provide everything we can to you. So glad you're here with us, as I said. We have great music, a great message, and we'll be able to take communion today. Thank you.
Hey, Westridge family. It's so nice to be with you guys again, even if it is just through social media and a recording. I just wanna let you guys know that I miss worshiping with you guys, and I miss being in the same building with you guys. And so I know that we're still going through some crazy times, and it seems like there's just so much information out there. And this week I was challenged to really focus on what the Bible says about what's going on and how I should be feeling. And because I know there's a lot of us going through some anxiety and fears and things like that. But I just want to read this real quick to you guys. It's Romans 15:13 says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with the hope by the Holy Spirit, by the power of the Holy Spirit." And I think that spoke to me a lot this week, and I think it just reminds us that we need to not be focused on the fear and the worries that the world can cast down on us, but focus on the Word of God. And He promises to comfort us and give us peace. And at the end of the day, he is our final hope, and he's our only hope that we should have, you know. So as we go into this worship time, I hope that just resonates with you, and it helps you seek his word more this week, and it keeps your head out of, you know, dark places, and that you can find hope and rest in him. So let's worship.
Yeah.
cast my mind to Calvary. When Jesus bled and died for me, I see his wounds, his hands asleep. My Savior loved that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still, and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Thank you.
before the Lamb of God and see your word. You were the of it all. You were the of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
As we come time to communion, I just want you to invite you, if you have bread, if you have juice, to have it with you. I want to point out what Paul says in 1 Corinthians to the church. He's reviewing, he's writing to them, and it's recorded, it's in chapter 11. He says, then the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and then he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. What's a greater time to do it when we're all separated, but we're all together as believers? The whole church is all together here at this time. And I just invite you, if you're a believer in Christ, if you understand his death, if what it means to you, and then have faith in Christ, I invite you to partake in communion, as it's a special time for us to remember what Christ did for us. Let's pray. God, just thank you so much for what you've given us, for the fact that we can come together even though we're so far apart, but ultimately we remember what you gave, what you've done in your life. Just the ability to come here, I can't even put it into words what you would do, what you would share with us. You broke bread that night, you drank wine, and you did it for us. We just thank you for that, and as we take communion now, we just invite all believers to do that with us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I am ready. Okay. Welcome, Westridge Church family. I hope you're all doing well. I hope that we're all praying for each other. This is a good opportunity for us to be mindful of each other in prayer. And it's also a great opportunity as we get into the message today, just to be reminded on what a difference we can make in times like these as believers in the Lord. The theme I have chosen for this Easter season is Jesus is near. And that'll be the theme as we go through Easter. We have three messages prepared. Today, because he is near, we are free to do good. Even in troubled times, even with smiles, we can do good. Next week, we can comfort each other because he understands our deepest sorrows. And he has joined our suffering, or he wants to join our suffering if we'll let him. And we can learn to be a comfort to others. And Easter, he is near, and he has miraculously empowered us. He has miraculously empowered us to be able to do his will. Recently, I was able in my personal study to go through the Gospels and also went through the book of Acts. And I selected Acts chapter 10, verses 37 through 41. So if you are following today, that's where the whole text is going to be. I'm going to read in a few other places, but where most of the message is going to be from right here. Acts 10, 37 through 41. Let's read it together. You know what has happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, and how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. Amen. Most of the message is going to come from verse 38 this morning. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. Amen. One of the first things that's striking about this is that Jesus went around. You know, when John the Baptist came on the scene and began preparing the people of Israel for Jesus, he stayed put and he stayed by the Jordan River, and it said the people came to him in the wilderness. He even had disciples and people that he was training. And in, not to be critical of us, but in many ways, that's the model the church has done through the centuries, is we have parking lots and buildings, and people come to us and they get discipled and they get taught, and we worship. And what's so amazing is that Jesus really did not do that. It simply says he went around doing good. Isn't that amazing? Of all the things that Peter could have said about Jesus, is that he went around doing good. You know, it's amazing in Jesus's 3 years of ministry, his life was defined by interruptions. I mean, it was just interruptions all the time. And I'm going to tell you, you know, this whole coronavirus, it has been a big interruption to our lives. And we've had to find new routines and we've had to adapt. And, you know, but Jesus was, you know, he ran into the Samaritan woman at the well. He ran into the Phoenician woman. They were on their way somewhere with his disciples. And then he ended up talking to the Phoenician woman and healing her daughter. He was on his way to Jerusalem to teach in the temple, and he ran into blind Bartimaeus, and then he had a whole meal with Zacchaeus, and it was crowds and storms and people, and all the time Jesus was dealing with interruptions. It's really neat in Matthew 28:18 when we read the Great Commission, and we were told to go, and that's what Jesus modeled for us. Jesus was always on the go, and he was always going, and he always made time for people. You know, I'm always struck by one healing. He was with his disciples, and a man covered in leprosy came. You know, what would you do? Talk about an interruption. How would you handle that if somebody so obviously sick walked right into the middle of your discipling session? You know, most of us would think we should run away or walk away, but not Jesus. He encounters this man and he talks to him, and he doesn't heal him from across the room or from across the way. He literally reaches out his hand and touches him and heals him. Isn't it amazing, the example that Jesus sent? The man covered in leprosy was just as important as teaching his disciples. And in Matthew 28, he does. He says, go. I've heard some scholarly men say, as you go. And we'll discuss that. And it says that he went around doing good. Isn't that amazing? Jesus went around doing good. Seek to do good wherever we're planted. You know, this made such an impression on Peter that he would say this about Jesus' life. That if you were to put all the Gospels into one verse, like Peter did here in the book of Acts, he went around doing good and healing people. It's so amazing. In his letter to the churches, John said, live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and give glory to God. For it is God's will that by doing good, you should silence the talk of ignorant and foolish people. Live good lives among men so that it honors God. Even a little later, he says, who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? You know what's amazing? When we just jump in and we begin just to do good right where we're at, if it's taking a neighbor some food, if it's helping somebody get their car unstuck, if it's looking out for an older person in your neighborhood, if it's buying somebody's groceries at the grocery store, everywhere we go good, we please God. And that's what Jesus did. He went around doing good. And it was noteworthy to Peter. And so in his letter to the church, he just over and over keeps coming back to this idea of doing good. It says that he went around doing good, healing all who were under the power of the devil. You know, we have an opportunity to model joy, and we have an opportunity to model peace in times of trial, and in times when our culture is being, when we're panicking, when people around us are panicking, when they're uncertain, we have this wonderful opportunity to model joy in peace as we're going around and doing good. You know, it says in Philippians chapter 2, do everything without arguing and complaining, in which you shine like stars in the universe. It's amazing to me, even when times are good, if you are just in the workplace or even in a church serving project. I mean, when we literally take this to our hearts and we do things without arguing and complaining, even in the church family, we shine like stars in the universe. I love how Paul makes it simple in how we're to live. In 1 Peter 5 and verse 7, Peter just simply reminds us, cast all your anxiety on Jesus because he cares for you. See, we have that. We have that anchor. And could I get infected with this virus? Could I lose my job? All these different things that go with us. We have somebody near us that we can cast our anxiety on, and that's Jesus. And the world doesn't have that. So we can do this. It's amazing that if we made a decision to just go all about our day, all about doing good and going around with joy and peace, what a witness it could be. Peter tells us in chapter 3 of his letter to the church, always be prepared to give an answer for someone, to give somebody a reason for the hope that you have. Isn't it amazing? People should be able to detect that we're different. And in times of trial, in times of uncertainty, we should have a calmness and a peace from knowing the Lord. And we have every opportunity to go around doing good and offer healing to people by our heart and our attitude and our prayers for them. Speaking of our prayers, Stacy, our prayer team leader at Westridge, she sent out a special announcement just reminding us that this is one thing. This is one thing that we can, it's one bit of doing good that we can do, is to pray for each other and to pray for our nation, to pray for our leaders, to pray for our schools and our teachers, to pray for our first responders. There is so much good we can do praying, and it's good for us to do it. The prayer team is being active through all this separation that we have, and we also have Westridge Online. You can check that announcement. You can send it your prayers through an email account, but also you can just text Stacy or any of the elders, and we can make sure your prayer request gets where the prayer team can pray for it. So we have so many opportunities to do good in times like this. And the last part of verse 38, how he went around doing good, healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. Isn't it amazing? God was with him. That's where it all comes from. That's how Jesus could be so effective in his ministry, is because the Father was with him. And he said that he didn't do anything apart from what God wanted him to do, that he followed the Father. He not only said the right things, but even said it in the way that the Father wanted him to say it. In John 14 and verse 18, he says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Jesus is offering to us, Jesus is telling us that just as he was with the Father, we have an opportunity to be with him, and therefore be with the Father. He has revealed the Father to us, and he is with us. That's why we can be good and do effective things, because Jesus is near and he is with us. So we can go around, we can do good with a smile, with joy and peace, And we can, as we have opportunity, we can do good things and we can pray for each other because God is near. In verse 39, let me just pick back up. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him, even after he rose from the dead. You know, John in his epistle, to his letter to the church, he said, that which our eyes have seen and our hands have touched. You know, Jesus did not bark out orders from the cloud and from his power and his majesty. He came and dwelt among us, and he allowed himself to be leaned on and touched by people, men and women. Our eyes have seen him and our hands have touched him. You know, Peter reminded them, we were responsible for his death. He died for us, but God raised him from the dead. You know, it's not our message. It's God's message. There's something spiritual as we're going around and displaying this joy and this peace, as we're going around and trying to do good, let's not forget two things to say. He died for you, and God raised him from the dead. It's not our message. It's his message, and there's power in it. It's always a seed. It always makes us think. It stays with us. God died for us because he loves us, and God raised him from the dead, and he's going to give us that same power. So don't be afraid to say it. When you're talking with family, you're talking with hurting people, don't be able to be afraid to say, God loves you, he died for you, and he rose from the dead. Let's remember that this Easter season, in this hard time that our world is having. Let's go around, let's do good as we have opportunity. Let's pray for each other. Let's pray for our government, our church, and let's be a difference maker because Jesus is near. Amen. Thank you.